designing these apps, of course, we've been paying a lot of attention to the devices. We want it to work with all the coolest devices, and we have to learn everything about these devices to make our iApps work. So the iApps know all about the devices. But a thought occurred to us late last year that the devices don't know anything about the iApps. There's never been a device that's been built that can take advantage of all this amazing intelligence built into these apps running on a Mac. What if there was? What if somebody built a device that could take advantage of knowing all about those iApps and get a level of integration that no one's ever achieved before? And we decided to do it. And the field that we decided to do it in,
camera,
the choice we made,
DVD player,
was music. Now, why
music?
Well, we love music, and it's always good to do something you love. More importantly, music's a part of everyone's life.
It was a little bit less sycophantic applause back in those days.
It will always be around. This is not a speculative market. And because it's a part of everyone's life, it's a very large target market all around the world. It knows no boundaries. But interestingly enough, in this whole new digital music revolution, there is no market leader. There are small companies like Creative and Sonic Blue, and then there's some large companies like Sony that haven't had a hit yet. They haven't found the recipe. No one has really found the recipe yet for digital music. And we think not only can we find the recipe, but we think the Apple brand is going to be fantastic because people trust the Apple brand to get their great digital electronics from. So let's look at portable music. Let's look at the landscape. The first thing, if you want to listen to music portably, you can go out and buy a CD player, right? That's one way to go, about 10 to 15 songs. Or you can buy a flash player. Go out and buy one of those. You can buy a MP3 CD player, or you can buy a hard disk-based jukebox player. These are the four choices for portable music right now. So let's take a look at each one of those. A CD player.
While Steve gives us the breakdown of CDs and other devices, good morning, good afternoon, good evening. This was our landscape back then. We had little flash players. I have one here. We had little devices like this that had like, you know, a few megabytes or gigabytes on there. Well, not gigabytes back then. We had CD. We had MP3 CD. We didn't have a portable music player that you could put in your pocket with 1,000 songs. That was all about to change.
You can go buy a hard drive jukebox player for about $300. It holds about 1,000 songs and cost about 30 cents a song. So we looked at this and studied all these, and that's where we want to be. That is where we want to be. And we are introducing a product today that takes us exactly there, and that product is called iPod. iMac, iBook, iPod. What is iPod?
They just laughed at him back then.
Is it an MP3 music player.
No applause after every statement. It was actually quite nice.
CD quality music. And it plays all of the popular open formats of digital music, MP3, MP3 variable bitrate, WAV, and AIFF. But the biggest thing about iPod is it holds 1,000 songs. Now, this is a quantum leap because it's for most people, it's their entire music library. This is huge. How many times have you gone on the road with a CD player and said, oh, God, the CD, I didn't bring the CD I wanted to listen to? To have your whole music library with you.
This struggle was real in 2001. Having, you know, your little CD holders with all your CDs was 100% what you did.
The coolest thing about iPod is that your entire music library fits in your pocket. Okay? You can take your whole music library with you right in your pocket. Never before possible. So that's iPod. There are three major breakthroughs in iPod. Let's take a look at each one of them. The first one is it's ultra portable. So if we're going to keep 1,000 songs on iPod and it fits in your pocket, how do we do this? How do we possibly?
Yep, no WMA, no M4A.
We start off with an ultra thin hard drive. We've got a 1.8-inch diameter hard drive.
Remember
that's
when
0.2 inches thick.
Remember when that was
super thin?
Thin? Yeah.
And that
it
hard
seemed
drive
revolutionary.
Is 5 gigabytes in capacity. 5 gigabytes, which holds 1,000 songs at 160 kilobit rate. which is a very high quality
32 gigabytes
of MP3 compression. Very high quality.
It was early days.
Thousand songs on this 5 gigabyte drive. And we've built in 20-minute skip protection. That's not 20 seconds. 20-minute skip protection. So you can take iPod bicycling, mountain climbing, jogging, you name it, and you're not going to skip a beat. So we've got this 5 gigabyte drive that holds 1,000 songs. How do we get the 1,000 songs on to iPod? We don't want to wait, so we've built in FireWire. Now, Apple, as you know, invented FireWire. We should FireWire on every computer we make. It's built into iPod. It's the first and only music player with FireWire.
Nothing quite dates anything like FireWire. If you weren't aware, before USB, I'll just put Steve down for a minute. Before USB, FireWire was much, much faster, and Apple kind of put all their eggs in the FireWire basket, and here they're going to show why it was so much quicker. And remember, they were comparing to USB 1 at this point. So, yeah, things changed considerably over time.
On iPod with FireWire, it is under 10 minutes. On a USB player, it is 5 hours. Can you imagine that? You get your USB player, you want to load 1,000 songs, you get to watch it for 5 hours while it loads the songs.
They look enthralled.
Under 10 minutes with iPod. It's 30 times faster than any other MP3 player. So, huge win. Now, it doesn't matter how many songs you have with you if your battery's dead, right? So we have built in an extraordinary battery into iPod. 10 hours of battery life, and that is 10 hours of continuous music. We're using a rechargeable lithium polymer battery. This is a more advanced battery than we even use in our portable computers. It's the most advanced battery we've ever shipped. And you can recharge this 10-hour battery in 1 hour to 80% of its capacity on a fast charge. 1 hour. But maybe the coolest thing is that, you know, FireWire, the FireWire cable carries all the data from the Mac to iPod, but FireWire also has power on it. And so when you plug in to your Mac, it actually charges the iPod over that single FireWire cable. So you don't have another charging cable to worry about. It charges over.
And again, we take that for granted now, but devices used to have a data connection and a power connection. They'd have a separate power socket for charging, and then they'd have their usually serial and then eventually USB port for actual connection.
This charger has a FireWire port on it. So you take your FireWire cable and just plug it right into the charger.
Oh, and you're probably thinking, what about PC? Yeah, they weren't caring about PC at this point. This was a product to plug into your Mac.
So 10 hours of continuous music playback with a remarkable new battery technology. Now, you might be saying, well, this is cool, but you know, I've got a big hard disk in my portable, let's say my iBook. I'm running iTunes. I'm really happy. I got FireWire on my iBook. I don't quite get 10 hours of battery life, but iBook's got better battery life than any other consumer portable. So what's so special about iPod here? It's ultra portable. An iBook is really portable, but this is ultra portable. And let me show you what I mean. iPod is the size of a deck of cards. A deck of cards. It is 2.4 inches wide. It is 4 inches tall. And it is barely.
And you got to remember that, like, this was about the size of the old sort of jukebox recorders. They were about the size of a chunky CD player. So this was actually tiny for a hard drive based MP3 player back in 2001.
So this is what's so remarkable about iPod. It is ultra portable. We didn't stop there. iPod has got Apple design. We've got one of the best design teams in the world, and they have done a remarkable job. And let me show you. This is what iPod looks from the side. Again, about 3/4 of an inch thick.
To get to the casino, Jade.
I'm going to show you the back first because I'm in love with it. It's stainless steel. It's really, really durable. It's beautiful. And this is what the front of it looks like. Boom. That's iPod. I happen to have one right here in my pocket, matter of fact. There it is, right there.
Yay. Finally got the applause.
So, this amazing little device holds 1,000 songs. And it goes right in my pocket. This is the top of iPod. You can see the two connectors, a FireWire connector, which supplies both the music and the power, headphone jack, and a hold button.
Woot, headphones!
That's iPod, woo! And we ship it with a wonderful set of earbud headphones. Amazing Apple design. Now,
seeing Apple design in that font, it's kind of funny.
Than music. Because we've got a 5 gigabyte hard drive in it, and we've got FireWire, and so iPod is also a FireWire hard drive. You can actually use it as a FireWire hard drive and drag your documents, your photos, whatever else, right alongside your music on it, and use it to transport those to another computer. As a FireWire hard drive.
All you have surprisingly to do is hard to do on an iPhone these days. Hard drive,
and that's it. And your iPod is now a FireWire hard drive. So, iPod, 1,000 songs in your pocket. We think this is a major, major breakthrough. Our first major breakthrough, it is ultra portable. Two more to go.
What's it going to be?
Second breakthrough.
The overhead projector you're using?
If any of you have ever used a portable music device or any portable digital device, a camera, anything, even a VCR, you know that consumer electronics devices are not known for their ease of use. Well, our second major breakthrough is we have applied Apple's legendary ease of use to iPod, and the results are stunning. If you're going to have your entire music collection on iPod,
Nirvana, woo!
You have to be able to find your music fast by playlist, artist, album, or song, right? Hmm. And iPod lets you do exactly that. It's got a beautiful LCD display on it. It's backlit for low light conditions if you want.
I miss that display.
And it's got this really cool thing in the middle. What is that? Well, that is it's called a scroll wheel. And it was a real breakthrough in our UI design along with our software. It allows really quick navigation. It allows you to scroll through long lists very quickly. We've built in acceleration.
Love
so if you have a long list, you can get through it really fast. And it allows one-handed operation. You can hold the iPod and choose your music with one hand. We've also built in a piezoelectric clicker so you can actually hear it go round, which turns out to be a really useful thing as well.
So miss the click.
So that is our scroll wheel.
Click, 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 click.
Let me show you how iPod works. There's nothing like a demo.
Yes, old school Steve Jobs, live demo.
I've got a camera here pointing at iPod, right there. And here we are. So you can see my finger there. I bite my fingernails, so should have had a finger artist. But you can just see how, hear the clicker?
Love the click.
And you can just go through these. I can pick a playlist here. And I've got my favorites playlist. I can just search through my playlists. I'll just pick favorites here. And, you know, just pick any song I want to. So let's pick that one.
He has to wait for the song to come up. There'll be some pauses here where they're playing back music. We hear some Sarah McLachlan. We hear some Moby. So I'll just put them down in the background a little bit there. You know what music sounds like. And you can go listen to your own Sarah McLachlan or Moby tunes in your own time. Old school demos didn't require Wi-Fi. No, Steve couldn't get angry because all the people were using the Wi-Fi. Because did you notice that everyone was sitting there just looking at him and staring at him? That's because they didn't have mobile. The Wi-Fi wasn't ubiquitous. People might have had like a tethered laptop that they had some sort of internet connection back then, but it was very rare. Remember, 2001, it was a different time. Let's watch him scroll.
Let me go down to the end. I'll pick Yo-Yo Ma. And here's all Yo-Yo Ma's albums. It lists all the albums. I only have one on here. So I'll just pick this one album.
Classic
and
Yo-Yo.
And I can just pick anything I want. So just pick the first song.
Should be all right with Bach. Don't think he's very active in the copyright world. Although I'm not going to risk that. Yeah, look at them all. They're all just staring at this. And he's got a camera. Like, people are using legitimate cameras. By the way, the audio and video quality here is the best I could find. I know it seems like it sounds like he's talking underwater. But yeah, it's highly compressed and a bit of a dodgy rip of this. But yeah, again, people weren't recording these to play them back on YouTube. There was no YouTube.
I will go back to artists here and maybe pick the Beatles. I've got a few albums here. Abbey Road and Hard Day's Night, you know. Hard Day's Night, you know, pick a song. Very simple to operate.
We definitely won't be playing that because, he's impressed. He's impressed that you can play Beatles. we could do a whole different show about Apple and the Beatles and the Beatles not being on iTunes and then eventually coming and not being on streaming and all sorts of things. It's interesting, the Beatles world of copyright.
And I've just got a list of all my songs. I've got over 200 songs in this thing. And again, notice how fast I can scroll down to the end if I want because we have acceleration here. It's really nice. Right? Now, you notice also that iPod is capable of displaying non-English characters. We support several languages, and here's some Japanese songs. So I can just pick one of these.
I have no idea if this Japanese song is a copyright song, but we're just going to go with it. The only time I seem to see those like Chinese and Japanese characters on my thing is, has anyone had that problem where they get some weird error and suddenly it goes and yeah, it won't actually play, it won't show the song title, it just shows weird characters. Yeah, that's been my experience. Corruption.
On, which will randomly pick a song from a playlist or your whole library if you'd
Shuffle.
Like. We have repeat one or all songs on. We have a backlight timer. Let me just turn it on for a minute. This, when it's dark, doesn't look so good up here, but when it's dark, it's really gorgeous. And you can choose to have that backlight timer, stay on for a certain amount of time. You can set your contrast here, you know, whatever looks good. And you can turn the clicker off and on. We have a sleep timer on in case you want to go to sleep. You can set this thing to turn off in so many minutes. iPod works in multiple languages. So not only can you have music titles in multiple languages, but we can even put the menus in multiple languages. So as an example, we can put them in German here, right? Or French or even Japanese, right? Pretty cool. I'm going to stay in English.
And you can get stuck there because you can never find your way back.
So this is iPod. Playlists, artists, songs, settings. Very, very simple.
Do they keep zooming in on him every time they mention Japanese? That's like very casually racist.
Lets us not only rapidly find our music, but lets us use iPod with one hand. So that is iPod. We think we got a breakthrough in user interfaces to where it is now accessible to everybody to have 1,000 songs and find them and navigate them faster than if you only had 10 or 15. On a much simpler device. A big breakthrough, Apple's legendary ease of use applied to a consumer electronics device. Third breakthrough, auto-sync. So let me start by backing up to iTunes. iTunes, as I mentioned, has been an unabashed success. We have distributed over 6 million copies of iTunes. Our users love it. They can build music libraries, digital music libraries, right on their Macs by ripping their CDs. They can burn CDs. They can listen to internet radio stations. They can make playlists, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Great visualizations. iTunes has been wonderful. Today, we're pleased to announce iTunes 2. iTunes 2 has the three features
they should have stopped at iTunes 2
for most. And they are MP3 CD burning right from iTunes, crossfading, and an equalizer. So let me give you a real quick demo of these three things. Let me launch iTunes again. For those of you that were watching carefully, it was iTunes 2 that I launched before. And let me go start with the crossfader. I'll go to a playlist like Monday Morning, and I'll play a Beatles song, and I'll skip to the end of it so you can hear the crossfading.
I think you probably know what crossfading sounds like. Yeah, it was interesting that in 2001, the first gen iPod was 5 gig, and then they released a 10 gigabyte version. Original release date was October 23rd, 2001. So yeah, you probably know what was going on just before then. So iPod had that additional challenge of it being, 2001, as well as, trying to release a revolutionary new product that still ended up being successful. So they kind of had the cards against them a little bit when it came to this. Still playing music and crossfading and equalizing now. So again, I don't know if anyone's ever used the equalizer. Most people turn it on by mistake, like they turn on one of those presets by mistake. And I actually get questions from people saying, my music sounds all bassy and terrible. And I'm like, did you just turn your equalizer on your iPhone on? They're like, what's the equalizer? I don't get it. So yeah, still playing the tunes. That dude looks cool. He looks like he's like, it's still the 90s, right? It's still the 90s. I could hang on to my little goatee beard and long hair and backwards cap. Still playing some Sarah McLachlan again, are we?
Now, MP3 CD burning. Back. Let me pick a playlist. Let me pick a Road Trip here. I've got 152 songs in Road Trip, about 10 times as many as will fit on a normal CD. So I'm going to put in a CDR disc, just a normal, 50-cent CDR disc, blank one. And I'm going to just say on Road Trip, let me go ahead and burn this. And iTunes will recognize that all those songs can't fit on a regular CD, and it's going to say all the songs in this playlist will not fit on an audio CD. iTunes can create MP3 CDs, which can be played in MP3 CD players. Which do you want? So it can put all the songs on an MP3 CD or just as many as will fit on a regular audio CD. And if I push MP3 CD, it will go ahead and...
That was zoomed in on the dude like about to yawn.
So that... last feature actually is we now support, again, international characters in iTunes, and we can just pick one of these if we want.
Sorry for the constantly up and down audio. Oh no, don't! Oh god, this is just horrific. It was a different time, folks. It was 2001. We didn't know any better. I apologize on Steve's behalf.
Okay, MP3 CD burning, crossfading, and an equalizer. These are the hot new features of iTunes 2. It runs on Mac OS 9 and Mac OS 10, and it's a free download. We'll be releasing it in early November on www.apple.com.
www.apple.com.
But those aren't the coolest feature of iTunes 2. The coolest feature of iTunes 2 is we have designed it to be used in conjunction with the iPod. The two work intimately together. And the coolest new feature is AutoSync. Remember I said earlier that devices don't know about iApps. Well, we're changing that. Because iTunes, not only does iTunes know all about iPod, but iPod knows all about iTunes. And so when you plug in the FireWire cable of your iPod into your Mac, automatically iTunes is launched, and all of your iTunes songs and playlists are automatically downloaded into iPod. You don't have to sit there dragging things over. Everything, your whole music library, is automatically downloaded into iPod. And as we saw,
which worked when it worked until it didn't. Okay. Notice again, people like writing down notes. I have like physical notepads there.
Some new music to iTunes. You rearrange your playlists, make new playlists, delete playlists, etc. Well, every time you plug iPod back into your Mac, it automatically updates with the latest and greatest information.
Unless it doesn't.
All automatically.
Unless it fails.
And so when you plug it in, you'll see something like this. It's updating the songs on iPod. And
having flashbacks
when it's done,
to waiting
iPod
for that.
iPod update is complete. And if you, most likely, if you've only added a few albums, you know, iPod is so fast, FireWire is so fast, just literally takes a few seconds. It's amazing. So what I'd like to do now is show you.
Show us, Steve.
I've got an iPod here that... I have been using. I've got a brand new one right here, and let's go ahead and let me just show you this.
Well,
brand
while he's demoing this, at the start of this, they showed iDVD, which was like the precursor to iMovie, because they thought burning DVDs was going to be the future. And as we know, a few years later, no one cared.
I'm going to take it over here, and what I'm going to do now is I'm going to go just simply plug it into iTunes. We've got the computer on the screen here. There we go. I'm going to plug it into iTunes. I'll just plug it in right now. It'll take a second to recognize it, and we'll see what happens.
Ooh.
All right. iTunes should be recognizing iPod in a second. There it is. And it asks me, since this is a brand new one, to name iPod. Now, it pulls the name right off my computer, so I don't even have to type it in if I don't want to. And it says, iTunes can automatically update your iPod to mirror its music library and playlists each time you connect to this Mac. Do you want that? And of course, if I don't do anything, it's already checked. And I just say, great, let's go.
Sadly, and so now a couple of years later, everyone was using Napster, and suddenly their music collections grew to much more than 1,000 songs. And you always had to choose, you have a specific playlist which you wanted to put on your iPod.
24 songs, 26 songs, 30 songs. It's already filled up 190 megabytes on my iPod. This thing's fast. And we're just
what was that, Jade? It was not iMatch, was it? That was different
this
again.
Will take well over
yeah, it was
an
bizarre.
Hour
some weird messaging
player,
thing.
And it's going to take us under 2 minutes here. And again, this is the first time you get your iPod. Each subsequent time you plug it in, it's only going to download the updates and changes that you've made since the last time it was plugged in. So this is the longest you'll ever see it take, and it's under 2 minutes for over 200 songs. Okay, we're already up, we're up to 500 megabytes we downloaded, over 100 songs.
It's funny that we've done a few of these now. We did the GarageBand 2004. We did the iPhone from, what, 2009? And then going back to 2001, yeah, the presentation has come a long way, baby. Bit of dead air. Wouldn't have that sort of dead
air. Over 150 songs, over 700 megabytes.
These days, their dead air is that really, like, poignant dead air where they're just like, it's a thing. And they just wait. What's missing here is the random applause. Woo. Love just a random in the background. I was going to cut all this out, but I was like, I can't.
Over 200 songs.
I have to subject you to it as well.
Look at this. Unbelievable.
I think Zuckerberg was in the womb.
We have downloaded over a gigabyte into iPod, over 200 songs. We literally just disconnect it and take it over here. I'm going to put the audio cable in its headphone jack. We'll pop it up right up here. There we go. Now, let's take a look. Playlists. Here's all my playlists. Right? I'm going to favorites. Boom.
Why were there three road trips? That's what I remember, having like multiple versions of the same playlist just sitting on there and going, oh my God, why did you sync that other version of it? Why did you duplicate my playlist and create a second version of it? I don't get it.
It's amazing.
It actually was amazing. Remember, this is nearly 20 years ago. No, sorry, Beatles. This was nearly 20 years ago. So it was actually revolutionary, but... yeah, I think they kind of missed their mark. The 1,000 songs in your pocket thing was good and interesting, and that's what Apple are good at, is selling on the benefits, not the features. So they'll sell you on the what it can do for you, not that... Because he said, yeah, it's 5 gigabytes, but he's focusing on the 1,000 songs in your pocket, plug and play, user interface. So
your music automatically, you unplug it, and you've got 1,000 songs in your pocket. Again, it's so simple to use, it's unbelievable. And because of the intimacy of iTunes and iPod working together, for the first time, we have a complete and seamless MP3 music solution. It's the first time this has ever been done. You know what it's like if you've had an MP3 player before. It's not been easy. This is trivial. So,
my first MP3 player was a Jazz Piper brand. It was 64 megabytes. It held about 20 songs if they were heavily compressed.
Applied to a consumer device and auto sync. There's been nothing like this before. And I don't think there's another company that could do this. To bring the hardware design, the industrial design, the application software design, FireWire, everything under one roof together to be able to create a product like this. It's pretty amazing. iPod. What are we going to sell it for? 5 gigabyte hard drive, FireWire, 10-hour battery, 1,000 songs in your pocket, $399. $399. Available in-store November 10th. Runs on Mac OS 9 and Mac OS 10. And I think I can say this with some degree of certainty, this is going to be the hottest gift this holiday season for every Mac owner.
Once again, Mac owners, because you needed a Mac.
If we could roll the video.
Now, I think, if I remember, is this video with, we might be able to watch it, but maybe not hear it. We'll see if we have some background music. Oh, no, this one's the ad. This one will be all right. Play some Dave Brubeck Quartet quietly in the background.
Where music and this whole digital world that we live in are starting to come together. And in this new digital music world, Apple has a lot of technology to bring to the party.
Oh, I might just play the rest and just wear the copyright strikes here just so that you can hear it. Okay.
We know how to make really cool small devices. We know how to make them beautiful and fun. iPod is this amazing digital device that fits in your pocket. It carries over 1,000 songs. So now you can take your entire music library with you wherever you go. This is a total solution. You can iPod, FireWire, iTunes with all your music in it, and it all works together seamlessly. And only Apple can do that, as we make the hardware, the software, and all the technology that allows us to solve problems for people that no one else would dare take on.
I think that the design of the iPod turned into a really personal project. I mean, I love music, the team loves music, and I think collectively, I mean, it's a product that we're really looking forward to getting our hands on.
The iPod is so fun and easy to use. You just take this cool little device, you plug it in over FireWire to your Mac, it launches iTunes, takes all your music, all your playlists, and automatically transfers it down onto your iPod, and then you can unplug and just go. It's so fast, it can now transfer a whole CD in 5 to 10 seconds, and all your music in just 5 to 10 minutes. The iPod was designed for you to have your music to go. It's small, fits in your pocket, only 6.5 ounces, has over 10 hours of continuous battery life, and a super thin 5 gig hard drive. So not only can you take your music with you, but you can take your data with you wherever you go. The iPod is the first music device with FireWire, which is 30 times faster than USB and has power. So when you plug in your iPod, you both download your tunes and charge your battery. The iPod and your Mac work together as a complete solution. We made sure the hardware and the software.
Phil's still rocking the 90s little perm mullet.
That's one of the really cool things Apple can do.
I've had 3 MP3 players, and I haven't figured out how to use any of them. And this one, I held it, and 45 seconds later, I knew how to use it. I'm having a hard time getting my head around the fact that you could transfer an album onto this in 10 seconds. If I was 16 years old, I think I'd be able to deal with that a lot better. The design is really cool, I have to say. I don't know who your product designers are, but boy, you're not paying them enough.
The big design story is clearly the interface, and I think the simplicity of the buttons and of the jog wheel completely belie how powerful, how effective the interface truly is.
Johnny, looking hot.
It's really, really straightforward. You can choose a song, an artist, or one of your own playlists.
It's a beautiful thing.
That's it. It's so simple. If you hold the menu button down for a couple of seconds...
I love that Sister Hazel and the Propeller Heads must be going, yay, we're up there with Moby and Dave Brubeck. We'll be relevant forever.
It's completely intuitive. We're surrounded by loads of small products that are, I think, really difficult to use. I think our goal with the design of iPod was to design something...
Yeah, wasn't he like an electronic music producer? That's a little bit weird.
Somebody once told me the world is gonna roll me. I ain't the sharpest tool in the shed.
It doesn't take a rocket scientist to figure this thing out. And I ain't no rocket scientist. Let me tell you. This is incredible. And the nice thing is, it's super simple. It's got...
I totally forgot Steve was in this. Pad. Sorry, I'll let you listen to it.
The scroll pad's so smooth, it's flawless. You know, you're not going to skip over something that you're looking for. You've got your own record store in this damn thing. This kicks every other product's ass right here.
Hey now, you're an all-star. Get your game on, go play. Hey now, you're a rock star. Get the show on.
Yes, I do remember Seal. I liked Seal.
Do you remember what it was like when you got your first Walkman? You remember that feeling? When you got a first Walkman in your hand, it was like, wow. Well, I haven't picked up any MP3 player that has made me go, wow, okay, I want to carry this wherever I go. This is the first thing that makes me feel, wow, okay. It's hard to say what the coolest aspects of it are. They're all cool. Obviously, the look of it, you know, everyone's going to want to have one of these.
Our goal was to design the very, very best MP3 player we could, to design something that could become an icon. And you know, we'll see whether that's the case or not, but certainly as a design team, I can't remember the last time where we were collectively lusting after a product as badly as we are after an iPod.
I might have to steal your prototype.
I'll take two of them. One for my girlfriend and one for me, because I'm not sharing this with nobody.
You can see the thought and the time and the love that's gone into it. It's just wonderful. I want it now.
Later that year, Seal was kissed by a rose and never heard from again.
I'd just love to take a moment to give a round of applause to Ruby and Sina and their teams, in particular Tony and Jeff, Johnny and his team, who's made this product possible. They've been really working hard. We started this program at the beginning of this year, and it's been a very fast-track program. So thank you guys for working so hard.
It's got a bit of a high school performance feel to it, doesn't it? Like with we got the people in the front row, like clap it up for the production team.
1,000 songs in your Mac, 1,000 songs in your pocket. Talks about iTunes, talks about AutoSync, talks about obviously iPod. And this insert's going to hit in November. We're going to be dropping 22 million copies in all the popular magazines, and we think this is going to be pretty cool. Also, this is a whole new category, of course, and no one's really educated the customers about this category. Nobody's made that investment. We're going to begin to make that investment with our inserts. And we also have a television ad that I'd love to run right now for you. So could we run that?
Let's watch the Apple ad, the iPod ad, and then we'll round things out. That's how we danced in the early 2000s. It was all in the head.
iPod, 1,000 songs in your pocket.
The goal of that ad is obviously to tell the world that there's something new about digital music from Apple.
There is indeed. There's something new, and its name was iPod. that was no iPhone announcement. That was no GarageBand announcement even. But it's one of those things where it's history, right? Like it's part of what created everything. And it was actually quite revolutionary. So as I mentioned before, my very first MP3 player was the Jazz Piper. Let's just see if we can do a bit of what I'm going to do is I'll take you down the Wikipedia lane here in a moment and just show you the previous version, like how iPod evolved over time. But just for a bit of nostalgia for myself, the Jazz Piper, the original MP3 player that I owned, let's just take a look at it. It was actually really slick looking. Where are we? There we are. So I'll pop this up here. just so I can show you what I was rocking. It was 64 megabytes, as I said. And yeah, this is what it was like. It was a little thing like this, a little tiny screen there. Yeah, there it is compared to like one of the Rio, the Diamond Rio. A few folks may have had that. Yeah, it had all the features, but like I said, 64 gigabytes. And I think I had a smart media card slot, so I think I added another 64 megabytes to it to maybe get it up to 128. But yeah, that would have been about $100 to buy like another 64 megabytes. So yeah, that was what we were rocking back in the day. But just to give you a bit of a feel for where we evolved to with the iPod, this is what it did. So you can go over to Wikipedia. This little chart's pretty cool. Like Wikipedia has a lot of these cool charts, and I know you won't be able to see it very well on your screen there, but the first gen, as you can see there, from October 23rd, 2001. And I didn't go through the whole 2001 thing because 2001 was the highlighted or lowlighted by one particular event, which happened just before the iPod release, which was, yeah, bad karma for it, but it got through. The first gen, the 5 gigabyte and the 10 gigabyte. We then went to 20 gig on the second gen. Third gen got USB for syncing only, still had FireWire for power, up to 40 gigabytes. We then went into the fourth generation photo, so you could put your photos on there. We then got up to the fifth generation, the video versions, the sixth gen, and then of course it sparked the whole pile of offshoots there. We had the iPod Mini, which I kind of liked. I liked the little design of the iPod Mini. We then had the iPod Nano, which went through a bunch of iterations right up to the seventh gen, which was virtually like a little mini iPod Touch at that point. Then we had the Shuffle there, and of course the iPod Touch, and the iPod still lives on. The seventh generation iPod Touch, which was only released on the 28th of May 2019, actually still runs. It's going to run iOS 14, would you believe? So you might think iPod is so old school 2001, but there is still an iPod that will run iOS 14 that's not coming out again, not coming out for another couple of months, and currently runs iOS 13.6, I guess, when that gets released. But yeah, it's still out there. iPod still exists, and it's just changed, and it's changed its format over the year. Yeah, the seventh gen classic looked really cool. Yeah, there was a like, and there's actually, if you've not checked it out, there's a YouTube channel called Dank Pods. Used to be Dankmus, a dude here in Adelaide, actually, who used to do really cool sort of Simpsons parody video songs, and now he's moved on to doing all about iPods, and he's done like the 1 gigabyte iPod. He's basically just trying to break iPods and find as many cool ways to hack and do things to iPods. So Dank Pods, if you want to check that one out. Yeah, the iPod Nano was outstanding. Jade says this was my first MP3 player. Let's see if I can. Oh, I can't get the link here. Damn it! I'm here in StreamYard. One of the drawbacks is I can't actually get the link to that, but I'll definitely take a look at that afterwards. And iOS 13.6 dropped today. Yeah, so we'll all have to go and update. I'm wondering if it's made any differences to anything. I don't know. I'll be updating on my device when I finish up on this one, which is going to be happening really soon. I added the new car key feature. Yeah, well, probably not buying the new BMW anytime soon. I'm looking for a new car, but not a BMW. And by the way, used car salespeople, my goodness. Anyway, completely unrelated. Let's continue. We'll finish up here. So let's continue by finishing up here. Question from Jade Walls. Where was it? Are you doing the iPad announcement next? I am. So we are going to finish off our iDevice series. We did GarageBand. We've done the iPhone announcement. Wanted to go right back in time to the iPod. This was the most cringy and the most like the least production value because it was 2001. But we will be finishing off the series next week by looking at the iPad launch. And if you think people were confused and wondering how they would use an iPod, yeah, when we first heard about the iPad, people are like, what is this? Why do I need a tablet? Like, tablets were just not cool, were not seen as useful in the slightest back in, what was it, 2011? No, I can't remember the year. There you go, I'm going to have to look it up. But I will be back next week to do that again to finish off the series here. I've had a lot of fun doing this, and thank you. I know this isn't for everyone. It's not going to be everyone's cup of tea, but for those of us that were around at the time and remember it and can have a little bit of a nostalgic trip down memory lane, I hope you enjoyed it. And yes, we're definitely going to get some copyright claims on this one. So hopefully they just send the revenue away and don't block the video, so that if you're watching on the replay, you can watch it. But if you caught it live, you got it. Alrighty, 2010 it was. Look it up. Well, I could look it up, or you've done the work for me. Alrighty, thanks everyone. Yeah, if you want more information, of course, you can head over to studiolivetoday.com. If you want to buy yourself a new iPhone or iPad, you can go to my iPad guide or iPhone guide. They're both linked right over there at studiolivetoday.com. Hang around now. Jade Star is doing her How to App series. If you're here live, or even if you're not here live, go over to Jade's channel. Just search Jade Star, S-T-A-R-R, on the YouTube, and you'll be able to find her channel. Jump over there and join us to find out about some more cool apps. I think you're doing Voice Record 7, one of my favorite apps today. That's going to do it today. Have a great one, everyone, and I'll see you next time. Cheers.